The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Marshall, welcome to the world of your own terrifying imagination. No storyteller is better loved than the gentle Robert Louis Stevenson, who wrote Treasure Island and A Child's Garden of Verses. But strangely, there was another side to Stevenson. He was also the man who could write the blood-curdling history of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And this tale of violence and voodoo you're about to hear, called The Beach of Falesá.
Here, take a look through my glass.
Thank you.
Catch a bit of white there to the east, eh?
Yes.
Yeah, that's your house. And George Underhill's already said, I've dropped into a soft thing here. Only saw him once more and he changed, all right.
What do you mean?
Well, I don't know if it was the gin or a strange kind of sickness, but they found him one morning hanging upsides down from his veranda rail, crazy as a loon, carrying on about someone watering his copra. He died in a convulsion.
Oh, was it thought to be the island?
Oh, no proof. But the next man, Vigors, shot his head. Blew his head right off. And the first of the line of the Benton Far East Company, old Adams... He just plain up and disappeared as though that damn tropical forest reached out like a octopus and swallowed him. Oop, line and sinker. No, sir. No, sir, Mr. Witcher, traitor or not, promotion with your company or whatever. You wouldn't get Captain Ben Randall here to set one foot on the beach at Falesá.
Mystery drama, The Beach of Falesá, was especially adapted from the Robert Louis Stevenson classic for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Alexander Scourby. It is sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, brewers of Budweiser. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Is the oil from the coconut and is used in the manufacture of soap and margarine. 75 years ago, when Robert Louis Stevenson was alive, young Britishers would mortgage 10 years of their lives in the Pacific Islands to make their pile and come back to England to establish a business of their own. This, then, is Henry Wiltshire's story, which he can tell better than I.
It might not seem like much to you, but when you've been down the line as long as I have, that beach at Falesá looked like a ruddy city. I mean, there were houses, what passed for a couple of streets, a church, and even a few of my own countrymen. For nearly 4 years, I'd been cut off in a mucky little island, maybe 15 miles long, but narrow enough so you could spit across it given the right wind. So, whatever the ruddy captain said about Falesá, I didn't pay him no mind. It wouldn't be long before I'd be finding out I should have. But right then, I was as excited as a kid at his first circus. Here's a boat coming now. She's right in the pass. Looks to be a 16-foot whaler. Two white men in the stern sheets.
Let's see that glass.
Aye,
that's Case, all right. And the pastor with him.
Case?
Trader with another company.
I'll be glad of somebody who speaks my own language.
Oh, I wouldn't be too sure of that. Jeremy Case has a gallows bad reputation.
You know what a place the beach is for talking. Well, it's right nice of them to come out to greet and fetch me.
Yeah. Not you.
Huh?
What'll you bet it's gin they're after, eh? I'll lay you 5-2. They take 6 cases.
When the two traders came aboard, I was pleased with both of them. One was a Kanaka, to be sure. Case would have passed muster in a city. He was smallish, had a hawk's nose to his face, pale eyes, and a beard neatly scissor-trimmed. It was clear he came of good family, was splendidly educated. He had the courage of a lion and the cunning of a rat. And if he's not in hell today, there's no such place.
A pleasure to make your acquaintance, Mr. Wiltshire. Jeremy Case bids you welcome to Falesá.
Thank you kindly. Sorry we're to be in competition.
Ah, it is enough for all. I pray you better luck than your predecessors. Oh, I'm forgetting my manners. This is our pastor.
Pleasure to meet you, Pastor.
Falesá, honor to have you join our community. We shall hope to see you at Sunday service.
Monsieur, Captain, it's a well-favored wind that's blown you our way so soon.
Oh, you mean Vickers left me a cargo of copra?
Sorry to disappoint you, Captain. Not a drop, I'm afraid, of either copra or gin. I'm only praying to God your ship is not as dry as his warehouse.
What did I tell you, Mr. Witcher? How many cases?
You couldn't spare six.
Well, even though I don't ship for your copra company, I laid in plenty. I'll have your six brought up from the old. Cash on the line, eh?
Yes, always. Mr. Wiltshire, sir, if you don't mind the suggestion, let's round up your belongings and load them in the whaleboat.
Well, I wouldn't want to be any trouble.
No, please, sir, let me hear no argument. Oh, there's nothing like gin and lime to settle the stomach, cool the brain, and ease the mind.
Yes. Very kind of you to stand me a couple at the bar like this. What's the name of this place?
Whistling Jimmy's.
Oh, must be a cheery sort.
Was.
Huh?
We caught him watering the copra. He took a bullet in the throat. Well, let's have another round.
No, thanks. I must be off for my house and stop to get things shipshape. Besides, I must not leave Mano alone too long.
Mano? Well, you could have knocked me over with a feather when you hauled that 10-year-old out from between decks and said he was part of your belongings. You are a strange man. How can you saddle yourself with a Kanaka brat, club-footed at that? What happened to the mother?
She was killed.
By whom?
Her husband.
Why?
For daring to bear an island chief a son who was not perfect.
And you brought the child up?
No, the child was hidden and brought up by its nurse. When I came as trader to the island, the old woman cooked and cared for me, and I learned to know the boy. Shortly before I left the island, the old woman died. When it came time for me to go, I knew that Manu would be left to die. He was taboo, you see. So I brought him with me.
For what?
Well, no one deserves to die before his time.
A man dies when he has to.
Well, I have no wish to quarrel with so generous a host, sir, but I must be off.
And I must go with you. Now, more than ever, we are ready to consummate the first rite for any man of our race on this island.
Huh?
Come, let's go.
Case insisted on paying treat and led me outside the bar. And I found myself staring at a crowd of girls, all dressed out for me.
Yeah, ugly, but the best we could muster, old man.
Huh?
Chap has to have a wife.
Oh, no, I'm not so sure.
You can have any one of these for a plug of tobacco. Besides, you have it all fixed up nice and legal. You just nip inside the bar once you've picked your chicken. Blackjack the bartender marries you nice and proper. He's a chaplain, you know.
Yes, but I don't want to marry.
Leave all that to Jeremy Case, eh? Out of it, as easy as in. Besides, you need a cook and someone to clean, and a man's got to have companionship or you go mad, yeah? Well, there now. Look them over.
Yes, well, I don't know. They all look a little broad in the bing.
Ah, not the one I've picked for you, lad. Look.
She'd just come up from fishing, wearing nothing but a chemise all wetted through. She was young and slender, with a long face and a high forehead. A shy, strange, childish look between a cat's and a baby's. Who is she?
That's Uma. If you take my advice, you take her.
Aye, but will she take me?
What choice has she? But if you like, I'll ask her.
He crossed to her and spoke to her in Polynesian. For a moment she spoke to him in her pretty Polynesian voice. And she nodded and came toward me with her free-swinging stride. She was the color of dark honey. Whether it was the breeze or for her as she stood in front of me, she smelled of wild lime and vanilla.
Me, Uma. I am no ever, no man's thing. You want me, I marry you.
I'm Sam Wiltshire.
Sam Wiltshire?
No, Wiltshire.
Yes, Wiltshire.
Well, I reckon that's as close as you'll get. You'll be calling me Sam anyway.
Yes, sir. Sam.
I suppose that'll do, too. Did Case tell you about the boy?
Mano?
Hmm?
All the same, you, son. Where's your wife? You have other wife?
No wife.
Good. Oh, please, Sama. I wish for marry you. But no like this.
Huh?
I no bumboat woman. I be dressed all the same bride. You see? And I no marry you inside there. I marry you here. In open air. When sun halfway from palm tree tip to sea.
Light as a feather, she was on her feet and gone. Not running, but moving swiftly. Her head held high as though she was a ruddy countess.
That means she'll be back about four-ish. Well, come on, we've time to hoist a few before the nuptials begin. Take a seat, Wiltshire. Excuse me for a moment. The bartender is also the minister, you remember?
Yes, Father Case. Gin and lime, please.
In a moment. We'll be drinking all round. And you'll need your paper collar. There's to be a wedding.
Ah, savvy. New trader, huh? Same kind of paper, like always.
Of course. I'll come with you and write it out for you.
Must I still not say who, lucky girl?
Uma.
Uma. No can do. Bad magic to a white man like that. Not with Uma. You know that girl.
I know that girl is the one to whom I want him married. To whom I will have him married. It suits our business. You understand?
Yes, Massa. If Massa say so. Black Jack know only one thing. This can only end bad. He's written in sand. Two people die.
What kind of man is this Jeremy Case? And what his purpose? By what combination of charm, legerdemain, or simple threat does he seem to rule Falesá, to hold its people in the palm of his hand? Last of all, why should the enormous man called Blackjack shake with an unknown terror at the impending marriage of the new arrived trader Wiltshire to by far the loveliest girl in the atoll? I'll return shortly with Act Two. Beach of Falesá, a tropical paradise. Surely one of the loveliest settings for the most sacred rite between a man and a woman. And in Robert Louis Stevenson's tale, certainly the scene was magical.
In his own words, the sun was down and the sky all afire. Uma was dressed and scented. Her kilt was a fine tapper, looking richer in the folds than any silk. She showed the best bearing for a bride, serious and still.
And I thought shame to stand up beside her before that great grinning mountebank with his paper collar, making believe to read from an old volume of some novel, of words of his service not fit to be set down. And the document we signed, since Case wrote it, let it be his voice to read it.
This is to certify that Uma, daughter of Falesá, of Falesá, is illegally married to Mr. Sam Wiltshire. And Mr. Sam Wiltshire is entitled to send her packing when he pleases. Signed this day, etc., etc., etc.
It was the practice in these parts. And all I could feel was so ashamed I had to be gone as soon as possible. Uma said she could show me to our house. Well, we strolled through the lush vegetation together until, forgetting myself, almost as though she was some girl in the old country, I unconsciously took her hand. To my surprise, after a sudden gasp, she caught my hand to her face and pressed it there.
Oh, you good.
It was all she said. Then she ran quickly up the path ahead of me.
It is good. Mucky, mucky, up, boy. No, no, Mano. But a father, you must be in English. He know my father. He is your Takashi. Without him, you be nothing.
Leave off, Uma. Don't upset him.
No. He must savvy. You are his tiki. You give him life.
Oh, we understand each other. Hey, Manbu. Right?
Right, you, governor. Put it there. Good night, Sama.
Good night.
This place be good. You bad. Good night, Uma. Tonight, Mano go sleep by and by Bahavo's house.
Why? This is your house.
Bahavo, see more better. Tonight is wedding night, Sama.
Oh. all right, I'll walk you and Falesá home, all right? During the walk back, my mind fairly reeled with all that had happened at first Falesá. I seemed to have suddenly dropped years from my life. Uma had kindled the lamp, and among all my tumbled possessions, she stood straight like a queen, the lamplight shining on her skin. I was ashamed of a wave of feeling I had for this native. Ashamed of the mock marriage and that worthless paper. I had to pluck up a lot of courage to enter.
Hello, Sama. Welcome. This, your home.
Aloha, Wahine.
No, Wahine. Me, your wife. That know what you want?
Damn, I know what's come over me.
Oh, what you do?
Huh?
This case with supply by Cobra.
This supply buys nothing but trouble. Get me an hammer, will you?
Yes, master.
S who?
Yes, Sama.
That's better. I could regret this. I could regret it 1,000 times. It isn't too late. But something good is happening. First, Mano, someone to take care of. And now...
Yes. Is Hama. What you do?
Miss.
That happy juice.
Yes.
Why you do that?
You know why we come here, Uma? From the other side of the world. We who call ourselves white and think we rule the world.
Trade for cobra oil.
Right. So we can make enough money to go back to the old country and become kings. But in the meantime, the rot sets in and the dream gets twisted. It's another world. A bloke don't belong. So he drowns himself in this. No good. A man who drinks is no good.
I think you one good man. Moon fade. Sun die. All the same. Uma belong you. Till I die.
For the next 3 days, Uma, Manu, and I worked our hearts out setting up the store and getting ready for business. I didn't see hide or hair of Case, but he told me he did a good deal of hunting and that it was very good in the bush, so I paid little attention. But Friday morning, we were ready for business. By Friday noon, not one customer had climbed the veranda steps. By Saturday morning, even the watching crowd of natives were gone. That night, I went to the bar in search of Case.
Evening, Master Roger. What do you like?
Nothing to drink, thanks. I'm looking for Mr. Case.
Oh, Master Case. He take trip one other island.
Oh, I see. Jack, do the people know my store is opening and I'm ready to trade?
Sure, Master, sure.
Then why don't they come?
Maybe no copra this time. Not rain. I not know. Just make drink for happiness.
Yeah. Jack, tell me, what happened to Vigors, the man who had my station before me?
Vigor, he was cleaning shotgun and...
Yes. And it suddenly went off and blew his head off?
Gun is bad thing.
In the wrong hands. Was Mr. Case on the trip then?
Oh, no. Mr. Case, I don't remember. I think maybe, yes.
And Adams, the one before?
He drink too much.
I see. What about Andy?
Talk too much, Master Welcher. People, they wait for drink this Saturday.
I left the bar feeling everyone's eyes on me. I'd been too long in the islands not to sense what might be going on. I just couldn't guess why. And I had a cold, shaky feeling at the base of my spine. There's something wrong, Omar. What is it?
Nobody come trade. Yes?
Yes. Why?
There be taboo.
Why?
Nobody will speak. How can Omar know?
One man knows everything around here. When he gets back, I'll know, or find out the reason why. Case?
Who's that?
Wiltshire, I want to talk to you. And put that pistol away.
Reflex action, old boy. Not much time to talk, though. I just got back and now...
I know, I've been waiting for you. Case? Here's a queer thing, maybe you can answer. I'm tabooed.
Now you can't be. Not possible. However, just to put your mind at rest, I'll scout round and make sure. Well, I rounded it up with the chiefs, and if you ask me, it's the worst kind of thing I've ever heard of.
I am tabooed then, eh?
Something of the sort. The people won't go near you, Wiltshire. It seems, for some reason, they're frightened of you.
You've gone crazy, Case. What are they frightened of?
I wish I could make out. It's like all their tomfool superstitions.
You haven't been to my house once, Case, since I came. Own up now.
I was busy. It was an oversight. I'm sorry for it. But about coming now, Wiltshire, I'll be quite plain.
Yeah? You mean you won't?
I'm awfully sorry, old man. But that's about the size of it.
In short, you're afraid.
In short, I'm afraid.
You belong here, Uma, if anyone can understand. Tell me, why am I tabooed?
You mean you no savvy?
How could I? We don't have such crazy things where I come from.
taboo belong all the same me.
To you?
Yes. He's want me for his woman, but I no want him. Just tell me, you love me so much, you no care. He no tell me, you no get cobra. So, I go away.
What?
I will go too. Then, you get much cobra. You like it, go better that way. So funny.
No, hold on, Holma. Kay seems to have played it pretty mean on the two of us. But I know now, and I don't want you to go away. I love you too much.
No. Tell me true.
Uma, I tell you true. I would rather have you than all the copra in the South Seas.
Oh. Now I die, little. Because I am so much love.
Me too. But, Uma, tell me, why are you taboo?
Mama! Mama! Listen! He's gone!
Who?
Missionary. He tell you everything more better from me.
As I came out on the veranda, the mission boat was shooting for the mouth of the river. So I started strolling down towards the river. From the opposite side, there was a man heading for the same place. And as he saw me, he started to run and got there first, as though to keep me from seeing the missionary. At the sight of him, rage flew into my nostrils and I raced him to the pier.
Get out of here, you low swindling thief!
Don't be a fool.
Well, I have been since I came here.
I have business here with the missionary.
So have I. And I don't want you eavesdropping, so I give you notice to clear out.
I don't take it, though.
He was quick with his hands, but had neither my height nor weight. Besides, I was blazing with a wrath that would have bit into a chisel. I hit him twice, once with each hand, and he went down with blood spreading on his face like a napkin.
Have you had enough? Answer me or I'll kick it out of you.
I could have put a bullet through you. Yes, enough for this time with the missionary and his crew as witnesses. But next time, I'll kill you.
Father Talton, sir. I'm Sam Wiltshire.
Denton Company's new trader.
The same.
You make a poor impression rolling on the dock with a man half your size.
A giant on this island, Father Talton. He seems to control it. Father Talton, I need your help.
It was Case that you knocked down?
It was.
You're either a brave or a foolish man. I can promise you nothing except extreme unction when you need it. As I fear you may, since I know no way to protect you from the evil Falesá casts on your kind.
Why should a missionary, constantly out of touch with the process of life as he travels from forsaken island to island, envisage the imminence of death? There are more mysteries that haunt these islands than the ancient one of Taboo. I'll return shortly with Act Three.
The pace that Wiltshire set up the hill to his house left poor Father Tarleton sweating under his bulky robe and more than a little out of breath. But if he harbored any unchristian thoughts about his host, they were quickly cleared when he learned the first purpose of his visit.
Now, here's the way of it, Father Talton. This is Uma, the woman I was married to by Black Jack.
The bartender.
Mr. Jeremy Case, Esquire, informed me he was a pastor. The certificate was written by that same Mr. Case, a dandy piece of literature, I promise you. But I'm not ducking any responsibility. I'm what you call a sinner, and I want you to help me to make it up to the person I deceived.
I shall be happy if I can.
Right. Uma, give me your marriage certificate.
Oh, what you want?
Come on, you can trust me.
You no hurt Uma?
Give me that and I'll show you.
Since I signed this piece of paper, I found I'm taboo in this place because of my so-called wife, and I cannot trade. I want to be married right, by a real missionary. So fire away, Father. Well, there was quite a to-do, I can tell you. Mano and Favao had to be brought in. Uma had to be back in her wedding togs. And I took the father aside and asked him to say the service in native to please the others. We had two of the crew in for witnesses. And finally, it was all bound up right and proper.
Mr. Wiltshire, I have rarely performed a marriage ceremony with more grateful emotions.
Thank you, Father Tarleton.
Do you want to know why your wife is taboo?
Of course I do.
I can tell you at least part of it. Old John Adams traded for your company. Shortly after he came here, he was stricken with the palsy. Massive, general. All of him frozen except one eye, which winked. Constantly winked. This vile fellow Case worked up the word that he was the evil eye, that he was the devil, and would destroy the island. He persuaded the villagers to take this poor old man to the other end of the village and bury him alive. Only one person tried to save him. Your wife.
I work for him. He kind. No jabber.
Case won two battles. He removed a rival trader, and he was able to punish Uma for refusing his advance. Because she tried to stop the burying, he said the evil eye had entered her, and she was made taboo.
But Case, he promised on Bible, my taboo, not yours.
It's all right, wife. I don't blame you. Father?
Yes, son?
It's all of a piece, isn't it? Biggers never blew his head off. That was done for him. Underhill, he was a bull's hound, which should have made it easy. He was poisoned. And Adams, buried alive. Now I'm tabooed.
The motive is obvious, even if we have no proof. A man like Case could only enjoy his single-handed control through fear.
Fear? What fear? He's only a man, and a small one at that.
But he holds some dread terror over their heads. I cannot stay this trip, for I am due at Farealihi. I will return as soon as I can. As for Case, without proof, there's little I can do.
Don't you worry about Case, Father. Now that everything's in the open, as it were, you let me handle Case. I didn't see him to speak to for several weeks. Meanwhile, Mano, Uma, Favao, and myself occupied our time making copra with our own hands, a piddling amount for all the labor. Finally, out of sheer frustration and boredom, and because we were tired of a steady diet of canned goods and local fruit and nuts, and to cheer up lonely little Mano, we went hunting. And I bumped into Black Jack. Hey, Jack. No road going eastward?
Oh, one time, one road. Now he dead.
Nobody he go there?
No good. Too much dabo he stop there. Man, he go there. No come back.
You know plenty about devil. You think me one?
Ah, no think. Devil. All the same fool.
Uma, she devil? Before he could answer, far across the bay, I see Case come out from the hanging front of the woods, a gun cradled in his elbow. Hello, my friend, you know talk all is saying true. Case go, he come back.
Case, no, all the same.
Huh?
Case,
Te Amoro. Uma, I met Blackjack when I was hunting today. And I saw Case coming from the east end of the island, where there's no trail. Tell me, Uma, what does Tiapolo mean?
Devil.
I thought Aitu was the word for that.
Aitu. Other kind devil. Live in bush. Eat kanaka. Tiapolo, big chief devil.
Mm-hmm.
Live in home. All the same, Christian devil.
And I'm no further forward. Jack says Case is Tiapolo.
No, all the same. He's belong Diablo. He's all the same his son. Suppose case he wish something. Diablo, he make him.
Well, that's right convenient. Like what? Out came such a rigmarole of stories I couldn't make head nor tail of them. It seemed that in the forest, Case had a church where Case worshipped. I now began to have a glimmer of how Case had acquired his position. And though he was a tough nut to crack, I was no ways cast down.
You no go there. I no like you.
Uma, nothing would stop me now. I want to have a look at that place of worship myself, and then we'll see about the glorifying.
But nobody go there, unless Diablo, he protect you.
I'll chance it with God's protection. I'm a good enough sort of fellow, I hope, for God to con me through. I left at dawn the next day, began to hack my way laboriously through the jungle. Queerness of the high bush is impossible to describe. Suddenly, I heard a sound that was so strange it chilled my blood and left me twittering in my shoes. But this was a sound my ear could follow. And finally, I spotted it and climbed a tree to it. Crudely made from a candle box with a brand still on it and banjo strings. A wind harp. I think the upper class name is Aeolian or something like that. All right for you, Mr. Case. You frightened me once, but I defy you to frighten me again. I slid down the tree, and coming to the bottom of it, found a path that led me to my destination. Rum sort of place, too. There was a wall no Kanaka ever built. Must have been century upon century old, winding around a longish mound of earth. On top of the wall was a line of queer idols, carved and painted faces, ugly to view, with teeth of shell, and brightly clothed with cloaks that blew in the wind. And other harps were sounding from all sides. In a moment, I was up over the wall into the mound of earth. Digging off the roof of earth, I found a tarpaulin stretched on boards. So this was the roof of a cellar. I climbed in. And there, around a corner, was a shining face of appalling ugliness, waxed and covered with luminous paint that occasionally smoked. Now that I knew how to fix Mr. Case, I went home.
I know, let you go!
I tell you what, you fish me out your Bible and I'll take that with me. That'll make me all right.
Maybe. But I know let Mano go with you.
Mano isn't scared of Aitu, not white man's. Right, Mano?
Mano no scared with Sama.
Besides, I need him to carry the fuses and the lantern. I have gunpowder, 2 dynamite bombs, gun, a machete to chop down those harps, knife.
Mano, go. He's no job for a woman.
That's telling her. Mind well, girl, I come back. Whole world is right. We almost didn't make it that night. Poor little Mano with his lame leg. But once there, it was easy. My charges set in the cellar, the harps hacked down as we passed them, the statues piled on the top, the fuse laid, my patent match lit. Only one small difficulty. On the way, half our fuse line had been lost, and I must have overestimated the amount of explosives needed. For when they caught... Keep your head down, Mano. You all right?
You betcha. Bow! Some are the same bingo bongo.
We better get out of here. Now, wait. Let me light the lantern. There. Now, let me lift it and see just where...
Nothing out.
Shh, what?
Well, why you talk so big voice? Case, he coming.
My God, Uma, is that you? You're not afraid?
Oh, too much afraid. I think I die.
Well, me too. How far is Case beyond you?
I not know. I lost. He be here. 1, 2.
Good Lord. And me with a lantern lit. Fool that I am.
Blow it out. Blow it out.
Mano.
And this is for you, Wilcher.
I've never had a leg bone smashed and tried to move. You've never known pain. It was a foolish move all around, for I couldn't reach my gun, and it alerted Case. He approached me carefully, his Winchester trained on me, his lips drawn back in a snarl that was supposed to be a smile.
You fool. If you'd left well enough alone, I'd have made some deal with you later.
Liar, you murderer. You have one more shot at me. Better be sure to be close enough so you don't miss again.
Right between the eyes. Are you ready?
I'd been as taut as a ship's hawser, but the moment he was close enough, I had him by the ankle, plucked the feet right from under him, and was on top of him with broken leg and all before he could breathe. His gun was gone, and he fastened his teeth in my arm like a weasel. Much I cared. My leg gave me all the pain I had used for, and I drew my knife and I got it in place. That's for Underhill. That's for Adams. That's for Vickers. That's for poor little Mono. And this is for Uma.
For myself. What is there left to care for? I have nothing left.
Where am I?
Home.
My leg?
It is set. It will heal.
Uma, you're all right.
Yes. I still your little wife. Bullet hit only shoulder. Soon heal.
And Mano?
He gone.
Huh?
Join ancestors.
Oh, poor little boy.
You listen me, my husband. Uma, your wife, I make promise. I bear you strong, boy. Take Mano's place.
As it happened, according to Robert Louis Stevenson, Uma bore Sam his son, just as she promised. And for good measure, two daughters, who fortunately looked like her. With the curse at last removed, Sam Wilshire wanted no other home than the beach of Falesá. I'll be back shortly. This was not Sam's headstone. It was Robert Louis Stevenson. But it might as well have been. Under the wide and starry sky, dig the grave and let me lie. Here did I live and gladly die, and I laid me down with a will. Our cast included Alexander Scourby, E.V. Juster, Ian Martin, and Robert Dryden. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
Now, a preview of our next tale. I tried writing about an actual incident out of my own life, but it came out garbage. Even I could recognize it was trash. That's when I heard the voice for the first time. Right out of the guts of the typewriter.
Get up, Dorn. Look at you. You're a miserable sight.
Can't be. I'm just hearing things. Typewriter that talks. I must be going off my rocker.
No, you're not. I exist, and what I say is real.
Who are you? What are you?
To start with, I am not a typewriter. I control it like I control you. You're both equally primitive mechanisms.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, Brewers of Budweiser, and Buick Motor Division. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.